Good afternoon, John and John. Good morning in Washington. We are very glad to host you in the INSS conference, dealing with where we going vis-a-vis the Iran crisis. I will start first with John Bolton at Washington, a good friend, expert for non-proliferation and arm control, and served until lately as a national security advisor for the President of the United States. How you assess the success of this policy, and how you are now will recommend the new administration to continue with it or to choose another policy. As we remember, the goals of the maximum pressure was to bring back Iran to the negotiation table to achieve a better agreement, or even if you aim higher, to make the regime collapse. How we are doing compared to these very ambitious goals?
Well, Amos, first, thank you very much for inviting me to participate. It's great to be with you, even if only virtually, and to see John Soares again. We had many dealings back in the day when we were both in our respective foreign ministries. I think the course of policy in the Trump administration is difficult to describe in a coherent way. It has a bumper sticker of maximum pressure, but in fact, I think unfortunately, it was not applied with the consistency and persistence that really would be required either to change the behavior of the Ayatollahs in Tehran or to change the regime. I think that what motivated the president at the beginning was the fact that in the 2016 campaign, he had argued against the 2015 Iran nuclear deal. And for him, it had been a very successful argument as part of his effort to get the Republican nomination. But I don't think it was fixed to a larger strategy. Indeed, this is one of the problems of policy, quote unquote, in the Trump administration in a whole range of areas. So that although the effect of the reimposition of American sanctions on Iran has been very dramatic, far exceeding the estimates that those who supported the JCPOA made, who said, don't withdraw, your sanctions can't be effective, the multilateral sanctions prior to the deal weren't effective, you going out on your own can't possibly change things. I think the fact is the U.S. sanctions and their reverberations around the world did have a dramatic effect. But the president didn't follow through in a consistent way with an aim either to change the behavior of the regime in Tehran or what I think in my personal view is the only way we're going to move Iran away from seeking nuclear weapons, which is to get a different regime in Tehran. And he sent mixed signals throughout in terms of wanting to deal with the Ayatollahs that ultimately led us to a series of unfortunate incidents that demonstrated to Iran that it was very hard to see what Trump would do on any given day, which is much the same way I felt during most of my time at the White House. So I think now the odds are that the incoming Biden administration will not change anything immediately, at least in a dramatic sense. I think they will find the Middle East is a very different place than when they left office at the end of the Obama administration. And I think they've got, I understand their position of wanting to get back into the JCPOA, but I think they're going to have to take a long, hard look at how to do that and what it actually means.
But once again, can you please beside criticizing your own side, when you look at the Iranians, and you're absolutely right that sanctions were much more painful and effective than people thought. But what needed more to achieve the goals of regime collapse or regime change behavior or coming to agree to a better deal? What is missing? Only time?
No, I mean, I think there are several things I would just say very quickly. Number one, my experience with economic sanctions in a wide variety of contexts over a long number of years is that they are most effective when they are comprehensively applied, effectively simultaneously with full enforcement up to and including military force. And I think what we saw throughout the utilization of sanctions after the U.S. withdrawal from the deal in 2018 was a gradual application of sanctions that actually gave the Iranians time to mitigate some of the worst effects. Now, it wasn't they didn't mitigate them all, that's for sure. But I think if we had imposed the sanctions in a more effective way, we'd be in a different place today, number one. And number two, I think the evidence is very clear that dissent within Iran is at an all-time level, really across all facets of society. The problem is that the regime still has the exclusive use of force, and that the United States and others didn't do anything to affect change in that, to fragment the leadership of the Quds force and the IRGC or the civilian aspects of the regime. I think there are ways to do that. And I think opposition to the regime is really stronger than people think. We may or may not be approaching a crisis of regime confidence when Khamenei dies. I don't necessarily believe the current rumors about his health any more than I believe the rumor once every couple of months that Kim Jong-un has died. One day those rumors will be true, but who knows when that will be. But I do think the regime is in weaker shape than is generally appreciated. And it's a tragedy, really. We're not prepared to take advantage of it.
Thank you, John. And we move to Sir John Soares, a former head of MI6. Which I had the privilege to work with when I was chief of intelligence for the IDF. And you are bringing to us today the European perspective. This is more speaking about multilateralism, working together, and you will have, I think, a partner in the other side of the Atlantic Ocean who will share with you the same approach. What is your personal recommendations how to deal with Iran now that Iran is not in compliance with the JCPOA? And which kind of policy would you think will be best to stop an Iran?
Well, thank you, General Yadlin. And it's good to be on this panel with you and Ambassador Bolton. The acoustics are a bit unusual, so forgive me if I pause from time to time. I think the first thing to say is to underline where there are common agreements between Europeans and Americans. I'm not speaking on behalf of Europe. I'm not even speaking on behalf of Britain. I'm just giving a perspective from my own experience on this. And first of all, Iran poses is the source of the greatest threat in the Middle East region, much more so than terrorist organizations. Iran has the resources of a state behind it. And I think the highest priority for dealing with Iran is to deal with the gravest threat, which is that Iran acquires nuclear weapons. And we need to find a way to ensure, as European and American leaders have said consistently, that Iran never acquires such a weapon, because it would be used, not so much used as a weapon, but it would be used to change the balance of power in the region. And we in Britain have nuclear weapons. People accuse us, critics say they've never been used. I say our nuclear weapons are used every single day because they affect the calculations of our adversaries about how they deal with us. Now, it's hard to identify exactly what it is, but it changes the balance of power. And we need to avoid a situation where Iran has such weapons. And it's not the only source of the problem, because Iran also is causing serious problem in the neighborhood. It has done so for 20 years in Lebanon. It's had an ally in Damascus. And in the last 20 years, it's added Iraq, perhaps courtesy of the 2003 war, and now Yemen, perhaps courtesy of the missteps of the Saudis, to the list of areas where it has opportunities to expand its influence and play a greater role. So we have a common platform of analysis. And it's a question of how do we proceed from that common approach. I don't have as much skepticism as Ambassador Bolton does about the effectiveness of the Iranian of the measures in the Iranian nuclear deal. I think they were insufficient. I don't think the 2015 deal was anything like as strong, for example, as the 2004 provisional agreement that the Europeans concluded with Iran, which put an end to all nuclear enrichment and indeed all nuclear conversion of uranium hexafluoride in Iran. But we couldn't bring that home, partly because the US administration came late to that party, and partly because there was a change of political leadership in the presidency to Ahmadinejad. Now, back in 2004, we reckon that Iran was 2 to 3 years away from having a nuclear weapon. In 2015, it was 1 year away. Maybe if they implement the measures that they've announced since the killing of Fakhrizadeh, they will be only 6 months away from a nuclear weapon. That's not much. That's not very encouraging. We have to find a way not just to destroy American Iranian facilities, but to try and build a path which ensures that Iran is not securing, making progress down the path to nuclear weapons. And at the same time, it has a pathway where it can normalize its relations in the region. We've seen in the past that Iran can reach agreements with us. For example, the 2001 Bonn Agreement on Afghanistan. For example, the 1989 agreement between Iran and Saudi Arabia on Lebanon. Iran is a country you can do deals with. And the successive release of hostages, Western hostages from Iran, show that you can do that. Now, I think it's wrong to think that the only way forward is to destroy the Iranian regime. As we've seen elsewhere, whether it's Iraq or Afghanistan or Libya or the attempts in Syria and Yemen, when you go for that sort of wide-scale regime change, the response is usually chaos and collapse rather than the move to a more favorable liberal order. In some ways, the best example is Iraq, but that's because Western forces have taken the bulk of the punishment of dealing with the collapse of authority there. So I think we have to find a way to deal with this Iranian regime, and the highest priority is the nuclear issue.
But if you look forward, and from your music, I hear that you are not a full supporting of the maximum pressure. What will be your recommendation? And you are not representing a formal government, but if you were now in a position of decision, what track would you take? Another negotiation? Go back to the 2015 JCPOA? Or you have some recommendation how to amend, how to close the loopholes?
Well, one of my lessons in life is you can never go backwards. You can never turn the clock back. Things are different. Actually, both Western interests and Iranian interests have been damaged by the last 4 or 5 years. And we would have to start. You know, there are some areas that have some agreement. I think some of the elements of the JCPOA are worth preserving. The timelines are far too short. They always were. There was no provisions on controlling Iranian missiles. And I think we need to find a way to limit the numbers and range of Iranian missile capability. And we need to find solutions to regional issues. Yemen is the most obvious one, the one crying out for a solution, and we need to find a way forward in Iraq as well, so that Iran doesn't have a baleful influence on that country. I think all those are possible. I think the if we end up simply with maximum pressure, we will not find a path to agreements. The Iranians are a proud people, and they are surrounded by what they see as hostile powers. I think we need to somehow build a way forward, not some sort of feeble best endeavors approach, but hard negotiations with which are verified in their outcome and which solve these practical issues step by step, and which has a possibility of building some degree of trust. Now, I suspect Ambassador Bolton will take a different view from that, but I think what I'm saying would broadly reflect the views of European countries. I suspect it probably reflects the views of some of those in the Biden administration, but we've yet to hear them really speak out on this beyond some of the remarks that the president-elect himself has made in his recent public comments.
Before I move back to the Ambassador Bolton, you described a comprehensive approach towards the threat of Iran, the nuclear, the ballistic missiles, and their regional behavior. I hardly see the Iranians willing to come to negotiate on the nuclear issue. And they are saying we are not moving from 2015 agreement, and the Americans will pay compensation on the time that they impose sanctions on us. What will be your position if the Iranians will continue to say, this is our position, we are not coming to negotiate?
Well, I do think that, as I say, both sides have been, to some extent, scarred by the last 4 years. We have some additional leverage. The sanctions that the United States has imposed provide some extra leverage for the Biden administration to use, and I think it's something to use wisely, not just to give away. And I know from my own dealings with Iran, I was our chief negotiator with the Iranians from 2003 to 2007. And I then served on the UN Security Council, where we tightened the pressure on Iran through a series of Security Council resolutions. And then obviously I followed Iran closely, although I didn't have contacts with them, whilst I was chief of intelligence service. A country's public position, especially a country like Iran, is very different from its private negotiating position. You have to manipulate the space between those cracks. Iran has its own politics. Iran is not an open society. It's certainly not a democracy. But there are groups within Iran that negotiate and maneuver against one another as a battle for power. It's not like Saudi Arabia. It's not like Iraq under Saddam Hussein. It's a complex society where there are political pressures which either expand and open opportunities or close them down. And we need to be skillful in how we deal with that and how we exploit it.
Can you refer to a future development and positions vis-a-vis a very tough Iranian position?
You mean from the perspective of the Biden administration?
Yeah. Difficult for
you. Not that they consult with me about what they're going to do, but I do believe that there is an awareness in among Biden's advisors, as John was just saying. I think there is in Europe too. The 2015 deal, leaving its own merits aside for a minute, and I'd be happy to come back and explain yet again why I didn't favor it. But leaving those aside. It was incomplete in many respects. And we've just seen the tension played out in an inartful way, but the tension arising over the expiration of the UN Security Council conventional arms embargo against Iran, which was a concession made in the negotiations for the 2015 deal, but by the West, by the U.S. and the Europeans, that never should have been made, never should have been made. I don't see how you can convince the Iranians to come back in and say, okay, we will agree as part of a comprehensive settlement to a conventional arms embargo. I don't see it. I also don't see any comparable carrot that the Europeans and the Biden administration will have to the unfreezing of Iranian assets that was an important part of the economic relief afforded to Iran in 2015, estimated to be between $120 and $150 billion. It's a hard number to pin down, but it was certainly a lot of money that helped put Iran back in a stronger economic footing, and that financed a lot of its conventional military activity and its support for terrorism. So the Biden administration is going to have, I think, difficulty recreating the magic that led to the 2015 deal. And I think that Iran's support for terrorism in the region, and maybe more importantly than anything else, its conventional military activity in Iraq, in Syria, linking up with Hezbollah in Lebanon, has changed the dynamic in the region to such an extent that that a nuclear deal alone, even if it were reachable, would seem significantly inadequate. And I just end with one last point. Obviously, the diplomatic recognition that's been exchanged between Israel on the one hand, Bahrain and the UAE on the other, with possible other Arab states coming, is an indication of the growing convergence of strategic assessments about the threat that Iran poses in the region. And unlike 2015 and the run-up, the negotiations running up to the 2015 deal, I don't think either Israel or many of the key Arab states are going to be restrained in expressing their concern about trying to recreate the 2015 deal. In 2015, they were largely silent, maybe complaining a little bit behind the scenes. I don't see that this time. I think they're going to take a much more active and public role against a deal they would see threatening their own interest.
Trying to clarify, you advocate a comprehensive agreement on, it's the same question I gave to Sir John Soros, nuclear, ballistic missile, regional behavior. If somebody will tell you, we can fix the nuclear deal according to Ambassador Bolton demands, leave the rest because the comprehensive agreement cannot be reached. It's too complex. It's too long of negotiation. We fix the nuclear issue, which is the more of concern, and we deal with our national mechanism power with the Iranian terrorists, with the Iranian proxies, with the rest of the Iranians' Malanian behavior. Would you take this policy?
No, I would not, because it's not simply Iran's indigenous capacity to create deliverable nuclear weapons. Something I have worried about for a long, long time is the Iranian connection with North Korea. So in answer to the question, how long would it take Iran to get nuclear weapons? The answer is a couple of weeks. How long does it take to load several warheads onto a North Korean tramp steamer and fill it up with fuel and send it on its merry way toward an Iranian port? That's how long it takes. And that's why fundamentally it's the regime itself that's the problem. It's not the weaponry. That's bad enough, that's for sure. But it's the nature of the regime that we're dealing with.
Can I just add, Ambassador General Yadlin, I don't think a single comprehensive agreement covering all those areas is likely to be achieved in one go. I think it's too much for American politics to absorb, too much for Iranian politics to absorb, however desirable each of the components may be. I think we're more likely to make progress if we divide them up. Now, yes, there's a case for linking missiles to the nuclear portfolio, but I think if you try to add in all the regional issues into a single comprehensive agreement, that's a recipe for failure. I share John Bolton's concerns about Iran's other options. I too have been worried that cooperation with North Korea might enable them to completely short circuit their nuclear development timelines. I'm also concerned about the wider strategic picture. You have a situation in Iran which there'll be a change to new leadership when Ayatollah Khamenei dies or steps down. You have a strategic partnership developing between China and Iran. You have, I'm sorry to say, it's a Trump administration negotiating the return of the of Afghanistan to the Taliban, who will be in the hands of under the influence of the Iranians as well. You have a risk of a large proportion of Eurasian landmass coming under serious sort of hostile, Russia would back it as well, hostile powers to the West. We need to try to ensure Iran doesn't end up in that grouping. And I think in over the next 20 or 30 years, we are likely to see the decline of the oil-rich countries in the region, simply because the price and value of oil is going to steadily decline, price and volumes of oil. The most important powers in the region are likely to be Turkey and Iran. And we want them both on the west side. And we need to find a pathway to keep Turkey with us, and gradually over the next 20 years to use the exploit the openness, to the extent that there is any openness in Iran, to our own advantage, and not rely heavily on countries which, I'm sorry to say, they're good friends of ours in the Gulf, including Saudi Arabia, but do not have a great future because they are very dependent upon one resource. And only one country in the region, in that region, the UAE, has made any real progress towards diversifying its economy.
So you touch on China, and there are two different school of thought about how important is the strategic agreement that China and Iran achieved lately. Some are saying this is an old agreement, they just reaffirm it, nothing is there, the Chinese will be very, very cautious because they need the connection with the Saudi, with the Saudis, they depend on Saudi oil, and they will not need Iran as the main ally vis-a-vis the United States in the Middle East. And others are saying this is the future of the Middle East, alliance between Iran and China against US, Israel, Western, pro-Western regimes. How you see it from your perspective?
From my perspective, I think we need to take it fairly seriously. I don't think China is a natural partner for the Iranians. Culturally, they tend to look more either to the West or to India. But if they have no other option, they will turn to China. For China, there's a big advantage here. And China is essentially a land power. Yes, it has aspirations to push America back into the sea. But essentially, their focus is on being the dominant power in the Eurasian landmass. That's what the Belt and Road Initiative is all about. I think their strategic vision is that, and this is something that Henry Kissinger has described before, their strategic vision is that the United States will remain a great power, but it should be an island power, separated from the rest of the world by two oceans. And China should be a land power, the dominant power on the Eurasian landmass. That affects us Europeans very directly because we're the other end of that landmass. And Belt and Road is designed step by step to acquire countries that pay their primary tribute, if you like, as the Chinese put it, pay tribute to Beijing, and are brought into line by China's economic power rather than by military means, but nonetheless increases China's dominance. And I think Iran is a very important step on that. They stand right on the path of the Belt and Road, and to bring Iran into China's camp will be a massive strategic gain for China. And the Iranians, I don't think it's their first choice, but if it's their only choice, it's one they will take.
Ambassador Bolton, I think one of the only bipartisan issue in Washington today is the great power competition, or even looking at China as a, even as an enemy. How you interpret the Chinese and the Russians supporting Iran and making every move, diplomatic or other moves against Iran, much more difficult when the two superpowers supporting Iran?
Yeah. Well, look, China is a huge issue. You should have another conference on China. John and I can come back and talk about it then. But just I'll just say with respect to China's recent announcement with Iran, I think there's less there than meets the eye. What China wants is oil. And their green credentials are a lot less than anybody else watching. I don't think they care so much. They are an energy deficit country in a very significant way. And, you know, Deng Xiaoping, when he was introducing capitalist economic reforms in China, said it doesn't matter whether the cat is black or white as long as it catches mice. And I think China's view here is we don't care whether the oil comes from Iran or Saudi Arabia. We want every option we can get to get oil from whatever source we can to feed the demand of our economy. So I think they're playing with their customary long-term approach to strategy. It's not like they've abandoned their contacts with the Gulf Arab countries, which are perpetually disturbing to the United States. I think this is a very complex, long-term issue here, and to me, it's a further reinforcement of the mistake that America makes, as it did in the Obama administration when he wanted to pivot toward Asia, to pivot away from the Middle East, mistake the Trump administration has made repeatedly for 4 years, most recently in the president's announcement of drawing down American forces in both Iraq and Afghanistan to 2,500 apiece. Those are numbers that have zero military significance. In Afghanistan, obviously, the very troubling negotiations with Afghanistan. You can't say, well, we're just going to worry about China. We don't have to worry so much about the Middle East. The United States has to worry about everything. That's our lot in life. And if we don't, we're going to find a problem somewhere.
Ambassador Bolton, you were, I think, near the president when he decided on assassination of Qasem Soleimani. And America used a kinetic power. It seems like an exception, because usually the Americans in the last decade thinking that any military action is by definition a slippery slope with unintended consequences into a full-scale war. What is the lesson learned from the Qasem Soleimani assassination, and America took responsibility to this action? And if you add to it General Fakhrizadeh, who had the secret military program of Iran, military program for the nuclear bomb, how you assess these operations in the general strategy vis-a-vis Iran?
Well, Amos, I'll try and answer that, obviously, without any reference to the specifics of Soleimani or Fakhrizadeh. And, of course, I don't know who's responsible for Fakhrizadeh. Maybe you have more information than I do on that subject. But I would just say this. I think the decision on Soleimani was the correct decision. And I think it's justified for many reasons well beyond the current tensions between the United States and Iran. To me, it goes back to the Iranian involvement with predecessors of Hezbollah who bombed the Marine barracks in Lebanon in 1983 and who are responsible for the deaths of scores of Americans in Iraq from explosively formed projectiles and other Iranian efforts, which they knew in aiding Shia militia and other groups in Iran, which they knew would kill Americans, and continues today with their support for Taliban activities in Afghanistan aimed at NATO forces there. I think what's interesting here, despite the concerns that people have about the use of force and what it may lead to, not every use of force does lead to a slippery slope. And in fact, for all of the bluster of the Iranians and for all of the capabilities they do have in the Quds force, which I don't underestimate, if you add Soleimani together with the range of attacks on Iranian nuclear and ballistic missile facilities over the past year and the attack on Fakhrizadeh, we have seen essentially no effective Iranian retaliation. And we have seen proof that all the world can see that Iran is very vulnerable to targeted use of force from the outside. I think this has to shake the regime to its very foundations and is a further sign that if we were doing this right, the regime itself would shatter. Now, I don't expect that to happen in the Biden administration, but I think that that there are splits within the Iranian leadership. I'd like to find ways to exploit them better, but I don't think that regime is anywhere near as solid as they would like to believe.
On the same subject, Sir John, can you refer to the fact that whoever assassinated General Fakhrizadeh haven't targeted only him? He basically looked into the outgoing administration, what they will do if the Iranian will retaliate soon, and what the next incoming administration will find on his desk after some escalation that will happen. What is your view about it?
Well, my view is that the norm of international relations is we don't kill people we disagree with. And any such assassinations have to be extremely well justified and isolated. Now, I wondered what the Iranian reaction to the Soleimani killing was going to be. I share some of John Bolton's analysis of the background to it and the fact that the Iranians did not respond directly. They have no wish to take on the full power of American might any more than Saddam Hussein did and learnt to his cost what the outcome would be. But the Iranians have shown over the last year that they too have precision capabilities. The strike on Abqaiq was very damaging and potentially hugely disruptive. I agree with John that the Abraham Accords between Israel and the UAE are a welcome step, and it's a hugely beneficial effect for Israel. Not sure how beneficial yet they're going to be for the UAE, because they've added to the scope for the UAE to be a target of Israel in any response in the way that the Saudis were before. That is something which we'll have to see how it moves forward. The Iranians are very skillful at asymmetric responses. They will not seek a like-for-like response to the attacks that they are under. They will seek ones which make it more difficult for the other side, and they will choose their own timing. I do think, though, that you know, the Europeans will all say that the Fakhrizadeh killing was illegal. I don't think the illegality is really the central issue of it. I think the central issue is what sort of response does it prompt? I think if we go down the road of a world where individuals are increasingly assassinated because we disagree with them or we don't like what they're doing, I think that's quite a dangerous world. It's the role that the Russians and the Saudis occupy, and it's not really the world that that the West wants to be in, and I don't think it's the one which, frankly, Israel should want to be in either.
Okay, we are towards closing. So I give you a free closing sentence, and if you don't have one, let's go to December 2021. Can you see a JCPOA 2.0 signed by a year from now?
Well, I'll take the first shot. I don't think there will be a JCPOA 2.0 by that point. I think that it's going to be much more complicated. I think to the extent Iran may be preparing a response to the Fakhrizadeh killing, they're going to wait until after January the 20th. And I think the whole region is a lot more complicated than they see coming in. I think that the geostrategic shifts that are taking place that the Abraham Accords represent are simply going to continue. I think the Gulf Arabs strategic assessment of the Iranian threat, not just nuclear, but conventional and terrorist as well, is growing increasingly close to Israel's. And while it may surprise a lot of people, it turns out the Palestinians are not actually uppermost in the minds of the Gulf Arabs. They are uppermost in their own minds. And so that tendency is going to continue. I think it's still worth efforts for the United States and the Europeans to see if they can't reach agreement, not necessarily that, as I think what John and I have said, shows it's not showed that that will be easy. But notwithstanding the Trump administration, I still think it's worth a try. And I think that as long as we never forget that the real objective here is to make sure Iran never gets nuclear weapons, hopefully we'll find a way to get together.
Well, as a last word on this, and thank you for giving us the opportunity, it's good to be able to agree with almost everything that that John has just said. I too don't think there will be JCPOA 2.0 in a year's time. I don't rule it out for 2 years' time, but a lot of things will have to fall into place for that to happen. But what I would say is that in the short term, it's always easier to use force to destroy things, to kill people. The harder task, that's the easy option, basically. The harder task in life is to build bridges, to build trust, and create an environment where people live at peace with one another. And I think the long-term interest of our Gulf friends, of Israel, and of certainly of Europeans, is a world which is ruled by a degree of legality and legitimacy and some level of mutual respect. Now, the Iranians are the ones who are way out of line on all these issues, but we need to find a way to bring them back into line. And I don't believe regime collapse or regime change will actually do that. I suspect it will be a successor regime would be even more violent and more repressive than the current one.
Thank you both, Ambassador Bolton and Sir John. It's remind me the good old days that we worked together in official positions, fighting against a huge challenges, but doing it together from different perspective. Each one of us serve his own country, but I think we shared in the past and we are still sharing the same values and the same interests and continuing with trusting each other. And this is very, very important. I really take on you, John Bolton, your promise to come and attend another INSS event on a great power competition, and Sir John with his experience and insights will be also very welcome. So good afternoon for everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amos. Thank you, John.